In this topic, we're going to discuss service bus considerations, why we might use service bus, what kind of things exist inside a service bus, how can we leverage this, and what features are available. Service bus is primarily a mechanism for us to allow us to, again, decouple our applications. It's a common theme in Azure, and especially with cloud-based applications, to be able to decouple the different layers. And this provides a enterprise-level queuing mechanism, as well as some other features that we'll talk about here. So great addition to your application when you're looking to decouple your application and really architect it for the cloud. So some of the things are basically from a high level, we basically have three different things that the service bus can provide us. It can provide us a queuing mechanism, which is very similar to our storage queue. We'll talk about that in detail here. I'll draw this out for you. And then we'll also talk about Relay. So Relay is kind of a nice feature that we came out, and this was very early on in Azure, to allow us to do hybrid connections. We're talking before we even had site-to-site VPN, before we had BizTalk hybrid connections. Relay was one of the primary ways for us to expose on-premises web services to Azure. So when we migrated our application to the cloud, how do we get it to talk to on-premises data? That was really the primary mechanism for that. And then we'll also talk along with queues. There's an associated topic called topics. And topics are really about filtering, and we'll talk about where those might be used. And lastly, we'll close up talking about event hubs. But to dive right into it, I'll do some drawing here, but essentially when we provision in Azure Service Bus, when we want to start using Service Bus, we have to provision what's called a namespace. And the namespace is simply just a name that we're going to associate with the Service Bus implementation that we're doing, whether it's a queue, relay, or topic that we were talking about before. So once we provision that, if we talk about queues, we would go ahead and create a queue inside of there. Now the queue is very similar to what we did with storage queues. It's going to house messages that are going to get injected into there, and has some of the same features from an API level for us to reach into there. So when we inject messages into there, again, we'll have some worker that's sitting over here listening. Could be an application, could be a worker process of some sort. He's going to go ahead and use exactly the same API we use for storage to go ahead and reach in and grab these messages and do some processing. Again, just a way to decouple your application and provide that. Now, if we said, okay, well, so what's the difference between, and this we'll call this a queue. What's the difference between that and a topic? So topics allow you to actually build these virtual queues kind of thing. So you would have a topic associated with users and maybe pictures. I don't know, for argument's sake. So we essentially now can inject messages into this, but what happens is they're actually wrapped in one big queue behind the scenes, but we have our clients out here, they create what's called subscriptions. So this guy will say, we have a worker over here that just says, I'm only interested in the user data, or I'm only interested in the picture data. So he'll set up a subscription to this. They'll set up associated to whichever topic that they're associated with. So it basically allows you to do this filtering mechanism. From the input side, we're allowed to inject whatever we want to. We just have one process over here that's injecting messages, but he's going to specify which topic to target. So he's going to say, this is a user message, this is a picture message, and when he injects those over there, the subscriptions are notified of that, or they can be also pulling to get that information. Now, if we looked at Relay, it's kind of a different animal altogether. So if we're talking about relays, we're actually talking about this scenario. So here's our service bus namespace, and actually our relay, we'll set it up here. And once we set that up, this stuff's going to be in Azure, and this would be our on-prem. So in the on-prem world, basically what we have over here is we would have a web service. Now, the one specific thing here, this can't be REST, it has to be WCF. So we set up a specific WCF binding to talk to this relay service up here. So this also is a service. Now what happens is, we can then have applications. Let's say we had a cloud app. Let's say we migrated an application from on-prem over here. So this is our app. And this guy needs to talk to some data that's on-premises. Let's say this web service talks to an on-premises database. What happens is when this guy makes a request to say, hey, service bus relay, I need access to this method, this data. He's going to say, oh, I know where that guy is. He's over here. And he's going to communicate with the on-premises and basically relay that information back to the app over here. Now, the interesting thing here is this piece, and that's really what the selling point was for this, was you don't have to open any firewalls here. So when we set up this WCF binding, it's actually making an outbound connection. So it's going up to the cloud. In that way, we don't have to worry about firewalls as much, because typically outbound connections aren't blocked, inbound are really blocked. So once we open that connection, what happens is we hold that TCP connection open, and now this relay up here has access to go ahead and send data back. And so that's really the magic of how the service bus relay does what it does. It's able to traverse firewalls and expose on-premises data. And the last topic we had there was around event hubs. Now, one of the things, especially with the IoT space or Internet of Things, which is a common buzzword now today, is being able to have thousands of devices all simultaneously sending data up to the cloud. Think about, for example, a connected car experience where we have tens of thousands or even millions of cars sending telemetry data up to the cloud. So in that model, how do you scale something like that? Yeah. I mean, that's really a hard thing to deal with. The cloud does great things, right? We could create our own web services to kind of scale that out. But what if we wanted to use something like Service Bus? And that's really where Event Hub comes in. So Event Hub allows you to basically set up a Service Bus. So we have our namespace here, and maybe we'll have our queues or our topics behind here. So we'll put queue top. And what happens is Event Hub kind of sits right here in front of it. And so the Event Hub is going to take care of handling this massive load of all these different things that are coming into here. And what the Event Hub will do is then kind of shield the service bus from that and be able to kind of filter it, not really filter it, but handle that huge impact of that stuff coming in there and be able to allow service bus to scale to that level. There's obviously limits around service bus, like how many times you can hit it per second. And so when we hit those thresholds, you'll start to be throttled, which means you won't be able to insert things into the service bus anymore. And this gives you that layer of abstraction to allow you to scale that massive load that's out there in the cloud. So when you're thinking about massive input where you have to bring in a lot of different data sources, think about event hubs. When you're thinking about something a little bit smaller scale, maybe you can get away with just a service bus queue or topic.
And it sounds like from what you're saying that moving forward in the future, I think this is going to become more needed as we increase our Internet of Things and devices.
Yeah, definitely in the IoT space, this is going to be a big thing because of the load that's involved. And that concludes our topic on service bus considerations for Azure.